In this, okay, now you will say, but also in nature, a species can vanish. Yes, but then it's simple external negation, Hegel would have said. It's not an inherent negation. Like, I reproduce myself, then a stronger animal comes, eats me up, or an asteroid hits me, I die. Okay, but this is, Hegel would have put it, totally external contingency. It can happen, of course, but it's irrelevant. The principle, again, of life is that the universality or the one remains by itself through the other. You interact with the other, and it is this very interaction which sustains you as the one. And of course, then this sounds very dialectical, like, oh my God, you see how it's the very change which allows me to remain the same. The moment I no longer change, I die, I'm not even the same, and so on and so on. But this is not what Hegel is about. Why not? For Hegel, there is something quite different which goes on in what he calls spirit, human history. It is, imagine it like this. If, oh my God, I think this, what is this? Can one?
No.
No. No. Why not? I mean, doing something dirty like Wolfgang, fuck off, and so on. You will not be able to. I like Wolfgang, but he pretends to be liberal. You know, he always accuses me, you are a proper Stalinist. But then, did you notice how, from time to time, you know, he's from East Germany, no? He denies it now, but the Stalinist. Discipline, blah blah. How then? All of a sudden, when you talk, all of a sudden you get a trace of this harshness. Like yesterday, did you notice how, when we were talking about Adorno, Habermas, and he said, "Yes, Habermas and Verretta." This is very hard to say. This is this brutal, a traitor, you know, like all this gentle Wolfgang, you know, or this Lassenheit and the traitor and so on. I love this. But I told Wolfgang he needs more of that. Okay. So again, here we have the one or the same. Life is this, how? And here we have continuous changes. Life is this, how the one maintains itself through the very process of changes. Again, as I told you, at individual level, you have to change to interact, precisely to remain the same. And again, people usually think this is dialectics. You see how sameness and unity are connected, the only way to remain the same is to change, blah, blah, blah. With Hegel, something different happens. Let's say we start with one. We have a process. But then, as I developed yesterday, you remember when I said how an idea in its realization undermines itself. We have one, an idea. I want to be this. Then I realize myself, in particular life, and the idea itself dissolves and another element, as it were, takes over. The change is at this level for Hegel. The change, the universal itself, it's not just the medium which remains the same. The changes are at this level. So that people usually say, but it all remains with Hegel within the same totality. The subject externalizes itself, then it swallows back the otherness, and so on. Yes. The idea comes back to itself, but to put it in vulgar terms, it's no longer the same idea. The idea, this disappears, and through the process, another idea comes up, which idea which was previously just a moment here. What do I mean by this? For example, take Marx puts this in wonderfully simple terms. Take the relationship of money and capital. First, money is the encompassing, no, even at the zero level, what runs the process are simply commodities. Commodity is the master. You produce something that you want to exchange. And money is just a subordinate moment. No? In the sense of, I don't know, I produce something, you produce something. We we exchange it, but then it gets too complex. What if you have something that I want and we need a mediator, money, blah, blah. So it's money. Here, at the elementary level, money still appears to be a subordinate moment. Then, medium of exchange. Then something happens with capital. It is that money, which was previously a subordinate moment, becomes the subject of the process. It's no longer commodity, money, commodity. It's no longer that, you know, this, again, as Marx put it, in a simple pre-capitalist exchange, the movement is commodity, money, commodity. I sell something in order to buy another thing. With capital, money, which was just the subordinating mediator, becomes the subject. So that it is what encompasses the process, the true subject of the process becomes what was previously just a subordinate moment, was money itself. The same goes for Marx for production. Marx put this in wonderful terms when he says that from the individual standpoint of the producer, you produce to satisfy your needs. But from the global standpoint, needs are generated in order to keep the production running. That the true goal of the historical process is not to satisfy your need, but is the development of production itself, and so on and so on. So,
is that Say's law?
Sorry?
Say's law.
Is that?
It's called Say's law in economics.
Oh, no, how do you call it? You see, here I'm an idiot.
S-A-Y-S.
Okay, yeah, but what does it mean? What does it say, this law?
The need generates the production. Or that the production generates the need, yeah, Say's law. You produce the goods, a need will arise.
Although I didn't even know that it's called Say's law, because, I mean, it's already, how should I put it, Marx said this already in a different way, and so on, even the early Marx, whom I intensely dislike, the humanist Marx, and so on.
Kind of reverses the usual capitalist formula of find that need, fill that need.
You
make the goods, who cares, and then eventually the need will just arrive.
You can say that. But let's remind.
It sounds. It sounds like Lewis Mumford's ideas on technological determinism, that the way of doing something becomes the reason for doing something.
But let's not lose a thread now. I agree. But these are all examples. You see how, and this is what Hegel is, how the process is a process of something, a subject. What happens for Hegel in spiritual, properly, dialectics, is that it's not only that the same reproduces itself through changes, is that the very encompassing unity, as it were, of a process changes. What, you know, something which was previously a subordinated moment becomes the totalizing moment. So what happens in history is not that a totality differentiates itself, no, that it historical process is rather a constant process of re-totalization. What changes, it's not that you have, let's take state again. You don't have a concept of state which then realizes itself in different forms. What is for Hegel at stake in historical changes is that the very general notion of what a state means changes. The struggle is at the level of universality. Let me give you an example. It's a simple one, but I'm not. Let's make something clear with all my evil so that you will not misunderstand me. When I say, let's take a simple example, the idiot I'm addressing here is me, not you. That is to say, I'm always obsessed precisely because I'm dealing with theorists who are usually considered difficult to read, even for some people bluffing like Lacan, Hegel. I'm obsessed with this idea. If you can't put it clearly, don't bluff about it, and so on. So I think that, again, we are back at what consciousness is, and so on. You know, the great art is not to play this complexity. The great